No good sidearm in the Star Wars universe is complete without an accompanying full leather, wet molded, perfectly formed, reaching down to the bottom of the thigh blaster holster. It is a fact. I mean, Han Solo's blaster holster is maybe the most iconic thing on the planet, like costume wise in Star Wars. And since I made my own a while ago, which I love, you can check out that video, link in the description. I wanted to do one, obviously. Of course, that started out with a fun drawing of what I roughly wanted out of it, which then obviously transformed as I learned more about leatherwork and what goes into an actual holster meant for real work and use, and I wanted to talk about that a little bit and then show you how I made it. So as you can see, I drew up a template for the holster. And I did this kind of based on other templates, mostly Han Solo's template, and I wasn't really thinking about the specific shape of how weird this thing is. Han's blaster, right there, this is raised up higher, and it's more separated. It's a lot smaller width-wise. Problem is that this is extremely wide, very tight to the body of it. And you've only got a little bit here to slide that through. And so I continued to think that Han Solo's blaster design would work. However, it turned out that it just wouldn't. So I drew up a template, kind of a rough one, and I was like, here, let's see how this works. The scope didn't fit anywhere. I didn't have enough leather to cover the scope fully, and it would have put dust and grime inside the scope that I didn't want. And overall, I just wasn't feeling it, and it wasn't going very well. And so I drew up a new template for it. It gave me a really good idea of what was going on. And this is basically the rough estimate for the final pattern. And again, it is all squished because it's been sitting under things and I pulled it out for this. It's been months and months since I've made this holster. So I'm finally uploading this video, which is good. So I marked all these things out and I said that, you know, there's a rivet for the snap. I put snap there, said this is a double layer of leather and things like that. And I basically marked it all up and told the procedure on this piece. So that was really helpful. And then I made kind of like a crappy, you know, test buckle here. It doesn't work very well, but it worked for those pictures. That you can see now, which was really cool because I got to see how it would all fit in, which was nice. So then I moved on to another version, which was essentially all the pieces on this one, except drawn out with a ruler. So this is what that one turned out like. It's on a thicker paper. And this one's good because I actually did the seam here. So I glued the seam where the seam would be. So it really is kind of like a basic form of what this should be. So to make room for the scope, which was a major issue, I had to do a thing that hasn't really been done before with any on-screen Star Wars blaster, which is that I had to make a weird stand-up flap here. And that proved to be a weird feeling thing, but it kind of worked. So I kind of learned on this project that you just kind of need to go for it sometimes. And even if it's not conventional, that you might get lucky. That was kind of nice that I, you know, rolled with the weirdness of the idea and it actually kind of worked in my favor. This is a tight fit, but the thing is that it still the blaster can still fit in here. And so I was relying a lot on wet molding to do this, and I did it just enough that it was a tight fit that I could also, you know, draw easily on the final leather holster, and it overall worked very well for that. So I was really happy that I was able to get that correct. And then with that, the final versions of these pieces, I added in the kind of like rules here on this, I don't know what to call it, the procedure. And I also wrote up a key on one of the pieces. And I also wrote up a detailed procedure of what I was gonna do with this. I really wanted to know what I was doing, and I did a lot of leatherworking research before this, since this was my first leatherworking thing. So I really wanted to make sure that I was doing it correctly. With templates, this is the trial and error part, and it's very essential that you mess up and make mistakes here instead of when you spend, you know, $40 on a 12-inch by 24-inch piece of leather. Just do yourself a favor, make a few templates, make sure that you assemble them and test them with your blaster. Just do this part correctly so that you don't have to redo the expensive part later. And I would say that that was a major, major plus when I was doing this. And with that, I was ready to start getting the holster built. Y'all, I am pumped up. All the things are here. Yeah, this is exactly what I ordered. All right. Oh my God, it's so heavy. That is gonna weigh 20 pounds. Huh? I guess I should break down what I have. So this is a 12 by 24 leather panel. This is 8 to 9 ounce leather. And I think it's probably about 3 millimeters thick, which is exactly what I wanted. This is a rubber mallet, leather needles, leather rivets, wool dabbers for applying, antique paste. This is Tokonole, which is meant to smooth down the edges. These are edge burnishers, which are meant to help smooth down the edges. Barge cement for gluing. Leather punches for punching stitching holes. Thread. This is a tool that has like 4 different functions, which is burnishing the edge. No, not burnishing. It cuts the corners off so that it makes it easier to round. And then it adds stitching grooves. And then it also adds marks for things like gluing. Snaps. Metric system ruler and a box cutter. Those are all the important things, and there are too many of them, and this is very expensive, and I owe some money. I'm gonna start out tracing some stuff and doing some tests.
So this is veg tan leather, which is some of the only leather that you can use for a holster like this, because naturally done, so it doesn't have any chemicals in it, which means that it's some of the only leather that can be wet molded and dyed. And you need wet molding if you're going to make a blaster because of all the intricate parts. So this is a 12 by 24 inch piece, and it's a 9 to 10 ounce piece of leather, which is what they used to make the blaster holsters in the original trilogy.
All right, so I'm just going to figure this out. I mean, I could probably turn it like that and then use that.
Sorry for the footsteps, I'm in my basement. So what I'm doing here is that I'm tracing the template on with a ballpoint pen, which works pretty well. As long as you're careful and you take your time, it should go okay. And that looks great. It's a good, clear cutting surface, and you're going to be beveling the edges, which is, you know, trimming the edges off, so you won't see any of the pen if you aren't slipping around when you're tracing the templates that you've created. And so there it is, all finished, and I was pretty proud of that.
Cuts. And time to fix that blade. Oh, whoa. That worked really well. Why does it make no sense?
Now, as you can see, I'm going over those little tiny parts there. I just traced big generalizations of the shapes and then trimmed them to size with a ruler, and used multiple cuts to go around the rounded edges. But don't try and do the intricate cuts the first time. And then there you go, finished pieces. And then right here, I am using a stitch groover to add the stitch mark. And this was extremely hard because my tool was very dull, but just take your time with it and go slow. And as you can see here, this is where it gets messed up. And eventually I just gave up because it just turned into crap. And that one's better. And now here I'm beveling the edges, as you can see. And so what that's doing is that's rounding them off and making them easier to burnish later. And it's also taking away that extra pen lines. And then I'm using some of that burnishing gum and a burnishing tool to burnish the edges. Fully burnished. I was really proud of how this turned out. And now I'm using a piece that's meant to just mark lines on leather to mark the place where I'm going to add the glue later to close that piece up. There it is. And now I just have marked the holes for where I'm going to add those rivets later on.
Okay, so I'm going to test hammering a rivet hole, and then I'm going to see how that goes. Jesus. I'm just killing the hammer. Real hammer. Perfect. Leather rivets. Holy shit! That isn't going anywhere. And that is how you mark a hole. That is awesome. Oh my god. It just feels so crazy that it's real, you know? Oh my god. It's like you draw these things, but you don't expect them to like come to life, and it's real, like it's right here in my hand. Update, I need to change the front part of it. What I didn't account for, scope, right? This piece, it doesn't fit. So I need to redraw that and then fix it again. Okay, all right. I actually kind of like that better than the original. Okay, kind of glad that the scope is all messed up. I like that. Okay.
So I just put the snap on there.
And I dropped it. That's fine.
Should be good. No.
Like in ceramics, you have to slip and score it.
Exactly. That's totally what I was thinking with that.
Probably shouldn't cut on top of here.
Smart move. Thank you.
Now we're going to talk about how you were going to glue pieces together, and for this I used barge cement. Now barge cement is great because it is a type of glue that's meant to sturdily glue things together while also maintaining their flexible properties, which is great for something like leather or EVA foam, where a major draw for it is that it's flexible and that, you know, that's part of it. So what you do is that you apply a layer to both pieces that you want to glue together, you let it dry for 10 minutes, and then you shove them together just like I'm doing now, and then you just apply some pressure or some weight on top of it, and then you let it sit for another 10 minutes, and that's pretty much it. So yeah.
So cool. I cannot believe this is actually happening. So while this is drying, I'm gonna make measurements for the leg strap.
So I glued that down and I punched the holes.
Now I'm gonna stitch that all up. And now we've reached the hand sewing part of this project. So for hand sewing leather, what people typically choose is a thicker waxed thread with a needle on either side so that you can stitch in a particular way that makes it so that it's really nice so that you can actually cinch down each little stitch that you do. And it's kind of hard to pull through those holes, as you can see I'm having some trouble with it. But once you get there and you are able to get into a rhythm and you get used to it, you are able to then, come on Will, pick up what, there you go, you can grab either end and just really pull it down, resulting in a really nice, clean, thick stitch that isn't going to break easily. And you can see here that I'm using some 60 grit sandpaper to sand down the edges, make sure that they're even. And then I'm also slicking down the edges just like I did before. And this all adds up to a really nice professional look, which I like. And I think it looks pretty good. And now I'm lining up where the belt loops and the main body of the blaster holster will line up, and I'm marking those. Then I am going to be scoring both sides, and then of course applying some contact cement, smoothing it out, letting it dry for 10 minutes. And then shoving those two together and applying some weight on top.
Okay, so I've done a lot. I know that I should have filmed it. I really, really just wanted to do it. And I was really in the zone and I just, you know, my phone kept dying. I was like, forget it. I'm just gonna do it and explain it. Cause I've basically just done everything that I've already shown before, which is I cut long, thin strips. I burnished them. I riveted them together right there to make it a little bit longer. And then all that I did here was add some snaps. The one part that I didn't show is that I shaved that down. Now that works perfect. I riveted those on there. I used 3 rivets right there. You saw that I glued it. So that's what I've done. And now it's on to the last step, which is gluing that and then hand stitching it and then going around that bottom part and then putting that snap on there, and then that's the functionality done. And I am very satisfied with this. This is looking awesome, and I really love that out of an accident came something way better.
So right now it's like, I think it's almost 12:30 or 1. And I completed the holster a while ago. Essentially, the wet molding went perfectly on this. Only thing that I got messed up was that when I was shaving this down to make it all one uniform thing, which it looks great, all three layers. When I was shaving this down, I accidentally went too far in here, and then it has this divot, and it looks absolutely terrible. But I decided to not try and fix it because I was afraid that I'd mess it up more. And then this seam line here is, you know, all messed up and being pressed against. So with this, the stitching is visible and it looks absolutely awesome. And then with this, the stitching is not seeable. And then I thought, I was like, oh yeah, I could just re-groove this line. And then I was like, I don't want to f*** this up any more than I already have. With this, I added a loop here. I riveted that down, but it just looks awesome. And the quick draw, well, not the quick draw, but just removing it is so great. It locks into place when you do that. And of course that snap is just, it works really well. So tomorrow I'm gonna be, you know, adding the antiquing and doing a couple tests and making sure that everything's doing good, and then do it on that. Yeah, I think it's good.
So really quickly, what I wanted to do was to talk about what happened with this holster. As you can see here, this is, again, you know, a long time later, so this has been weathered a little bit over time and over my usage of pretending that I'm a spaceman. So it does have a little bit more of like an in-universe look for like the weathering, which I kind of like. But as you can see, it's still the tan color. And why that is because I filmed footage of me antiquing scraps of leather, and it didn't look right. Because what I did, what I said earlier in this video, is that if you're going to add any kind of dye or finish or antique, anything that isn't a, you know, a balm or a, you know, any kind of protective thing for the leather, if you're doing colored, you shouldn't do the edge slicking process until after you've finished dyeing or antiquing your leather. The scraps just turned out really bad, and I basically thought, well, maybe if it's a larger surface area, I could test it. And so I put some on the back belt loops here. It wasn't turning out how I had hoped it would, so I didn't go forward with it. And I also did a ton of other tests, and I ended up dyeing the entire back of it, so it's not showing what it looked like before. So I did some tests on here, didn't look good, and then I ordered some dark brown leather dye. I'd already done antiquing on this, so I did the brown over that to do a test, and then I kind of went down and did that again, and then I also bought a yellow leather dye. As you can see here, it creates like an interesting kind of like yellowy, darkish, weathered look here, which is cool, but as you can see here, kind of, it's a lot lighter on this edge because the Tokonole has bonded this edge and has created a coat that covers it from accepting any of this stuff. So that if I had not slicked it down, I could have done this all over the front of it. However, it didn't go over well because I slicked down all the edges, and even worse, I got fingerprints of Tokonole all over this, so it would be spotty, and there'd be spots where it would have no dye on the front of this. So I kind of chose not to do it, but honestly, while it's not exactly Star Wars-y, I do kind of like the natural look of this. As it gets more and more weathered and used, like you can kind of see on the inside there, it kind of just starts to blend in with like that used look. And you can see that this is even like bent up because I've been flicking it out like this. It's kind of crinkling that, and this edge here is getting all wrinkled and stuff. And overall, it's just getting a little bit dirtier, and it's nice and thick because of the wet molding. And you know, I really like it, and I think it's kind of the proper amount of grime and grossness. So with that, we are done with this holster.